السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا، ثم أما بعد. And welcome back for the last session that we have tonight for this semester. And we're discussing here again the last session from the book of Imam Ibn Qudamah رحمه الله تعالى، مختصر منهاج القاصدين. You know, I remember, subhanAllah, looking at the book, and when was the first session we had? If you guys remember, for those who started with us studying this book, we started studying this book unofficially, I would say, was Ramadan, not this past Ramadan, Ramadan last year during the Tahajjud period. When we were doing the Atikaf, we started studying this book, and we started studying specific chapters of the book. And it was an amazing experience, alhamdulillah, specifically when you have this i'tikaf mode and you have, mashallah, the beautiful gathering at night when there's nothing to worry about except just focusing on the understanding of the meaning of the words of wisdom that Imam Ibn Qudamah rahimahullah was putting in there for us, the meaning of this life, the meaning of the i'tikaf and tahajjud and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then we decided to take it actually further and study the book from the beginning. And that's when we began right after that. So the first official session we had it was in January this year. And now this is December this year, so almost like a year since we started studying this book, and we barely got through one quarter of the book. In one entire year, just studying one quarter of the book. What I want you to learn from this is the fact that subhanAllah, when it comes to knowledge, you really don't understand how much you learn until you try to summarize and to go over it quickly. That's why every time you take a class, they want you to take a test. Why? Or even they ask you to put or submit the final paper, for example, or something like that. Why? Because by doing so, you won't really appreciate or realize how much knowledge you gain or you learn until you had to go through the material for the sake of taking a test or submitting a paper or something like that. So tonight, inshallah ta'ala, since it's going to be our final session, bi'nillah azza wa jal, we'd like to discuss together this whole quarter of the book that we learned together. What was it, and what did we learn exactly from Mukhtasar Minhaj al-Qasidin by Ibn Qudamah rahimahullah ta'ala? So if you guys remember, Imam Ibn Qudamah rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, he said that the book was divided into four major chapters or four major divisions and parts. What are these parts? He called them quarters. The first quarter, the second, third, and fourth quarters. Number one, he says, Rub'u al-ibadat. If you guys remember, the first quarter was about what? About acts of worship, devotional acts, al-ibadat. The first quarter of the book was all about devotional acts, al-ibadat, acts of worship. The second quarter was Rub'u al-adat, custom and tradition. The quarter about habits, custom, tradition. The third quarter, Rub'u al-muhlikat. We didn't get there yet. We still, inshallah, maybe in the future, bi'nillah azza wa jal. Rub'u al-muhlikat means the quarter of, what's the meaning of muhlikat? Do you guys know? Muhlikat. It's basically destructive behaviors and manners and akhlaq. These things that destroys is the akhlaq and the character, and destroys, the point he's making, that destroys the akhirah for you. What destroys your akhirah? He had a whole quarter from this book just designed to identify these aspects that will destroy your akhirah. And the last quarter, he would give us hope, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, by saying rub' al-munjiyat, the quarter of these practices that will save you on the day of judgment. So one of the quarters is about what destroys the akhirah, and the last quarter of the book was about what saves you into the akhirah. We covered together throughout this whole year, we covered together, that's one quarter, Rub'u al-ibadat, just the quarter of al-ibadat, and we barely started with Rub'u al-adat, customs and etiquettes and traditions, and we covered only from the etiquette of food and gathering around food. So let's see what we learned from the beginning. The first book, if you study any book of knowledge, what do you expect the ulama to begin with? The number one chapter usually, what would it be? Huh? Besides the introduction and saying Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah, if they want to start with any chapter, what would be that chapter that they would like to introduce to you? The number one chapter would be the chapter of? Even before Tahara. If you ever seen the book of Imam Imam Muslim rahimahullah ta'ala, for instance, and then Imam An-Nawawi, he wrote a commentary on Sahih Muslim. The introduction to his book was so valuable the introduction to this commentary was actually so valuable that the people and publishers, they took that introduction separately from the book itself, and they made it a whole independent volume, and it's sold actually independent from the book itself. It's called Muqaddimat Sharh Sahih Muslim. That it was the introduction to the commentary on Sahih Muslim by Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala. Why? The value of that introduction is because it was focusing on the etiquette of seeking knowledge. Kitab al-ilm wa fadl al-ilm means the subject of knowledge and the essence of knowledge and the importance of knowledge and the virtue of knowledge. All of these things that the Imam will be speaking about, and that's what he started with. He said, Kitab al-ilm wa fadlihi wa ma ta'allaqu bih. We learn, the first thing we learn about the al-ilm, knowledge, its virtue, and everything related to that. If you want to cut an ayah or a hadith related to the subject of knowledge, the importance and the virtue of knowledge, which ayah comes to your mind first? Who can help us here? Give me an ayah that comes to your mind whenever you talk about knowledge. Yes, Muhammad. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Amazing. Praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of all the worlds. True. But I want something more specific to knowledge. Can you think of anything specific about knowledge? Huh? علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. He taught man what he didn't know. What else? Yes. The angels, when they say سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا. Oh Allah, we have no knowledge but the knowledge that you give us, provide us, which means all the knowledge comes from whom? From that source, Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Yes. فعلم أنه لا إله إلا الله. Even the subject of learning about Allah سبحانه وتعالى, you need what? You need knowledge for this as well. فَعْلَمْ, have the knowledge that there is no God but Allah. There is much more, jama'ah, more profound. They're all profound, of course, but there is something much more direct about knowledge, the virtue and the value of knowledge. وَمَا أُوتِيتُ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. Whatever you're given from knowledge is nothing but little. Whatever you think that you have is still little. Which also can add to another ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. And above every knowledgeable person, there is whom? Someone who is more knowledgeable. So never think that you have enough of knowledge. Yes. اهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ. Guide us to the straight path. True, this is part of what we ask for, but I want something more specific to knowledge. How about وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. Jazakallah khair. The Prophet ﷺ was commanded in the Quran. He was never asked to ask for more. He was never actually commanded to ask for more from anything except for one thing. What was that? Knowledge. وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. And say, my Lord, increase me in knowledge. Allah Azza wa Jal did not command the Prophet ﷺ to seek for more from anything except for knowledge. وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. So whenever you ask for more, you ask for what? Knowledge. Most of us, when we ask for more, we ask for what? For money, for umr, for life, for more, from everything. But we just kind of, you know, just skip the most important thing, which is knowledge. Ya Allah, increase us in knowledge. What else from the ayat? How about قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Are they equal? Those who know and those who know not. That's an ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about it. And Allah says also, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. That truly those who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala among the servants are whom? The ulama, those who have the knowledge. So Allah subhanahu, there are so many ayat in the Quran speaks about the virtue of knowledge. How about hadith? Who can give me a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarding the virtue of knowledge? Hadith, jama'ah. Any hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about knowledge? Ladies, you can help us here too. I can't recall this as a hadith though. Yes.
But Allah wishes good for a person.
مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. If Allah wills good for anyone, He will increase them in knowledge and fiqh fi al-deen, understanding of the religion. What else? Yes, Abu Khalid. صحيح, بس بدنا حديث الآن. نريد حديث من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. This was an ayah now, but we need hadith from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Yes. طلب العلم فريضة. Seeking knowledge is compulsory. So you guys, you understand these ayat and a hadith, right?
Yeah, there's one hadith which is said, best among one is one who seek knowledge and achieves the
خيركم من تعلم القرآن وعلمه. The best amongst you are those who learn the Quran and then teaches the other. Okay, now do you guys understand the virtue of knowledge? Do you know, recognize now the value of knowledge? Do you guys recognize that? The question is, how many of us are doing it? How many of us are doing it? Jazakallah khair. You're here for to increase your knowledge, mashallah. Jazakallah khair. So you're practicing it already, mashallah. The question, Echo, is how often, if we truly understand the value of knowledge, my question to you is, how many books do you read a year? How many books? You know what? How many books, how many pages do you read a day? How many books do you really read a day? I know the age of technology, unfortunately, ruined, you know, the fact that the subject of reading. Why? Because all our reading right now is digital. So we go online, you read blogs, you read the news, you read Facebook, you read everything, subhanAllah. But because of this instant gratification, we get our entertainment of knowledge through these news feeds and clips and so forth. Now the fact that to grab a book became so classic. Even bookstores are closing nowadays. Why? Because not so many people are reading these classical books anymore. We go with Kindles, we go with all these kind of, you know, digital formats of books, but we stop reading the classical ones, and therefore, the culture of reading is kind of falling down, unfortunately. The culture of reading is falling down. But, Ya Ikhwah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the first ayah, the first word of the Quran, what was it? Iqra. It wasn't uktub, which means write. It wasn't isma, here. It was iqra. Bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Read in the name of your Lord who created. Now, for that, the ulama, they say that the most important aspect of knowledge is reading. And if you don't read enough, really, your ilm will always be confined and limited to what you know already. And naturally, if you don't increase that, what happens? It's not just that it disappears, it gets outdated. It really gets outdated. And scientifically speaking, they say that knowledge doubles, actually. Knowledge usually doubles every 900 days. The knowledge that we have in the world, it doubles every 900 days. How many years is that, ya jama'ah? That's less than 3 years. This is less than 3 years. Every 3 years, you could say, knowledge that we have in the world already doubles. So if you haven't read a book for the past 3 years, your knowledge is already outdated. Your expertise is outdated. And if you want to keep up, then you're going to have to keep reading and learning and reading and learning. You might say, well, I took this class many years ago. Like, for example, whenever there's an announcement, class on Sirah, which is the most popular topic, you know, people, they teach in the masajid. Class on Sirah, say, oh, I took that 5 years ago. It's already outdated, which means you're going to have to refresh your ilm and your knowledge every now and then. So never, ever stop seeking knowledge. And that's what he says. Therefore, the next chapter he made was talabul ilmi farida, that seeking knowledge is actually an obligation. And he mentioned that whenever we deal with, when it comes to the subject of knowledge, what's the essence of knowledge? Do you guys remember the essence of knowledge? Is the essence of knowledge learning the information, memorizing the statement, just remembering the words of the text? Is that what we call knowledge? Of course not. If I ask you to recite the Quran for me, you might be hafiz. You might be able to recite the entire Quran. But that's not what we mean by knowledge. What we mean by knowledge is actually al-mu'amala, which means what do you do with that knowledge? What do you do with that knowledge? Are you practicing it? Are you dealing with the people the proper way? Are you dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the proper way based on the knowledge that you have? That's what you need to worry about. So regardless of how many books you read every single day, it's about how much you practice of what you really know and what you're really learning. The ulama in the past, if you guys know, and if you remember, the ulama in the past, how many books did they have in their hands? How many books? Let's say the first generation, how many books did they have? The Quran. One book, right? The rest of it was just memorization of hadith and kind of circulating among the people. Later on, the ulama, when they start writing books, the number of books were limited to the people in terms of numbers of books, of course. But what was the quality of the knowledge that these little number of books produced to the community? Tons of knowledge. Tons of knowledge. Today, we live in an age that you cannot even count how many books are coming out every single day. Not just every single year, every single day. By the time you go to Amazon.com to check a new book, there are tons of books, new arrivals. You go to the public library, new arrivals. Bestsellers changes every single day, subhanAllah. Unbelievable. Why? Because the number of books that are coming out are so much that we cannot keep up with. But the quality of the knowledge that we have today is unfortunately is coming down. And therefore, if you really focus on what you learn and then you practice that, that is the greatest knowledge. That's the essence of knowledge. Now, Al-Imam Ibn Qudamah rahimahullah ta'ala, he divided knowledge into ulum al-mahmuda wa ulum al-madhmuma. Not all the knowledge that's out there is something recommended to study. There's so many knowledge out there, so many actually things to read out there on the internet, useless. There's so many websites out there that are considered perhaps the most popular website online, but they're useless. They don't benefit you in the akhirah. They don't even benefit you in the dunya. They're only just time killers, that's all. So not everything that is out there is considered valuable. So be careful. Not just because it's entertaining or it's nice and beautiful and fancy that you go and you read it and you learn that knowledge. No, you need to learn the knowledge that will benefit you in this dunya and will benefit you in the akhirah. But if that knowledge is not beneficial to you in the dunya and the akhirah, there is no meaning for you really, and there is no need for you to learn that thing. Unless, inshallah, once you finish everything, tabarakallah, and then the only thing that is left for you is to learn these kind of things, that's when you're going to learn these issues. Back in the days, Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said in his own words, he said that when he covered almost all the sciences that were available, all the disciplines that were available at his time, so he studied the Qur'an, the Hadith, the ulum al-usul, and fiqh, and so on. He just covered almost everything. But being a scholar and the alim and always inquisitive, he wants to learn something new and something more, he found out, you know what, the next thing was in his way is to study medicine. He said, I'm going to study medicine. So he checked the book of Al-Qanun by Ibn Sina. When he read the book, قَالَ فَأَظْلَمَ قَلْبِي. My heart completely became so dark. The terminologies and all that stuff, it just, so for me, that's not my thing. So he stopped it, and he went back again to refresh his memories with the ulum al-sharia as well. So some people, you're going to have to try to see if that knowledge is actually good for you or not. So you make a decision if to continue or not. Al-Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, then he mentioned, in the process of seeking knowledge, the adab, the etiquettes of those who seek knowledge and those who deliver that knowledge. Adabul alim wal mutaallim. The adab, the etiquette of the mutaallim, the seeker of the knowledge, and adab al muallim, the teacher over him. And if you guys remember what he said about al alim, that al alim should always start, if you're going to ever teach people, you always start with what? With the little things, the basic things, the standards, and then you move on to the major issues. So we're living here in America, for instance, when you deal with non-Muslims, it would be really useless to argue with them about, you know, how it's prohibited to drink alcohol and shooting drugs and eating pork and so on, when the concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is still vague in their minds. So the first thing you begin with is to teach them the most basic. And some people sometimes they like to even philosophize, you know, the basics of things, such as the concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the oneness of Allah azza wa jal. We try to make it, you know, so fancy by using a lot of terminologies and so on, when sometimes the basic fitri thing, which means not speaking to the heart, is the easiest way. Many of us, when we talk with people, we try to convince them intellectually, which is good. There's nothing wrong with that. But sometimes speaking to the heart is a shortcut, is much easier. When you open the heart to the fitra, and just move that fitra, that natural in it that Allah plays in their hearts, is the easiest thing to do. So as a alim, as a student of knowledge, as a teacher, always begin with the basic things, inshallah, before you start with the major things. That also includes with even your family and your kids and so on. And as a student, as being muta'allim for you, be careful. There are so many what we call them afat, which means pitfalls of seeking knowledge. And number one enemy of seeking knowledge, what is it, ajama'ah? What is the number one enemy for seeking knowledge? Can you guess? Huh? Al-ghurur aw al-kibr. Arrogance. The number one enemy for seeking knowledge is arrogance. Why? Because the ulama, they say there are two things that prevent a person from seeking knowledge or learning. You might be seeking knowledge, but you never learn. What are these two things that prevents the person from learning? Number one, they say arrogance. Number two is what? Bashfulness. Al-khajal. Bashfulness. Being, you know, shy. You're feeling ashamed of learning. So some people, they feel arrogant from learning from this person. Why? Because he's too young, he's too inexperienced, he's this and that and so on and so. But real ulama and genuine ulama, they will still sit and listen as if they've never heard that before. As if they've never heard that before, as if they're hearing it for the first time ever. And that's what the etiquette of the ulama. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَذَكِّرْ فَنَا الدِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. The reminder benefits whom? the believers. He didn't say it would benefit the heedless, the non-believers. He said it benefits the believers. So you, the believer, if you truly believe in that and you hear someone speaking something good and khayr and give an ayah or a hadith that you memorized before they were even born, you could still sit there and learn from this. Even if it's something that you've learned long, long time ago. That's the etiquette of the believer and the attitude of the believer. You always look for the khayr even in the things that you've learned so long time ago. And the other thing he says, bashfulness. Bashfulness is another killer for seeking knowledge. Why? Because bashfulness will prevent you from being inquisitive. And if you don't ask the question, you would never learn the mas'ala. So sometimes in a gathering like this, you look around and you see you're the youngest. And you feel so shy from asking the question because it might be embarrassing, might be funny, they might laugh at you. You know what? Let them laugh at you. I'm learning here. What's wrong with that? Sometimes you look around, you feel shy because you know what, if I ask this question, everybody's gonna say, oh my God, he doesn't know about this issue. So it's very embarrassing, very humiliating. These are the whispers of the shaitan. Regardless of the situation, you have to ask the question. You know what, if you couldn't ask the question in public, alhamdulillah, there is always room to ask the question in private. So you come and you walk with the imam, with the sheikh, with the teacher, and say, I have something private, if you don't mind, for a couple of minutes. And then you get your question answered, inshallah ta'ala. Never ever make kibr, arrogance, or bashfulness be an obstacle for you to learn your deen and learn that knowledge. Al-Imam Ibn Qudamah, rahimahullah ta'ala, after he spoke about seeking knowledge, he moved on to another chapter, another book. That is Kitab al-Tahara. So now that we know the essence of knowledge, the second was At-Tahara, purification. But what kind of Tahara did he speak about? You guys remember what type of Tahara? How many, what are the categories of Tahara he spoke about? You guys remember, anyone? MashaAllah. He mentioned actually four categories, if you remember them. Number one is what? Taharatul Zahir. The purification of the surface. Means from the outside. Your hands, your face, your feet, this is when you make wudu, that's when you take a shower, that's when you use the bathroom and wash yourself and so on. This is taharatu al-zahir. That's the purification of the surface from the outside. And then he said, ثُمَّ طَهَارَةُ الْجَوَارِحِ مِنَ الدُّنُوبِ وَالْآثَامِ. The second category is to purify your limbs, your hands, your eyes, your senses from what? From sins, from committing sins. So you make sure that your body is so pure. And since that you never use your hand to commit something haram, you never use your eye to look at something haram, you will never use your ear to listen to something haram, as much as you can, try to stay away from the sins and keep them clear and clean and pure. The third category, he says, تَطْهِيرُ الْقُلُوبِ, to purify your heart, مِنَ الْأَخْلَاقِ الْمَذْمُومَةِ وَالرَّذَائِلِ, means to purify your heart from these bad manners and bad akhlaq and etiquettes. And specifically, the etiquettes that are relevant are related to the heart. Like what? What are these akhlaq and manners that are, you know, concerning the heart? Like what?
Hasad.
Envy. Why do you have to envy other people? Even if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them more, why should you be angry about it? Just ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something more or better. That's all. Why envy? What else? Akhlaq of the heart, the etiquettes of the heart and the these things that comes in the heart. So we have envy. What else? How about love and hate? When you love for the sake of Allah. When you hate for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What else? How about fear? When you fear, you only fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely and genuinely. So there's so many things we need to keep in our heart. And these things we need to also, you know, to observe to be right and to be something useful for us in this dunya and in the akhirah. قال رحمه الله, and the fourth one, the fourth category, تطهير السر عما سوى الله. And here this is something extremely, extremely high. He said تطهير السر, which means to purify the essence. The essence, which means from everything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Means any thought that comes to your mind, any thought that comes to your mind, any intention that comes into your heart, whatever that you do, your life always revolves, goes around pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you have your heart and your mind, everything that is focusing only on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and pleasing Allah azza wa jal, there is no doubt, all your senses will be following that, and all your hands and your limbs will, inshallah ta'ala, will do nothing but that which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The essence is, this is of course the highest level, and people will start from one level to the other one. So you begin by purifying the surface. And when you perfect that, you start purifying what? You purify now your senses and your limbs from committing sins. And then as you do that in the process, what gets purified? The heart. And when the heart is pure, now that it's free from all these bad akhlaq and manners, it's ready to hold, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, to the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely and genuinely. Because you can't have the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your heart, you know, and many other things that are kind of desires that keeps pushing in, trying to get through. Because your heart is very limited, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ مِّن قَلْبَيْنِ فِي جَوْفِهِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He didn't put two hearts, you know, in man, in one man. You can't have two hearts. So therefore, that heart is supposed to be the vessel that carries the hikmah and the ni'mah and the khayr. And if you have all these akhlaq and manners competing with that, you can't have them both like this. Yes, you might have to a certain extent, but as much desire for this world you have, it will take from, of course, from the akhirah and from your love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Imam Ibn Qudamah rahimahullah, then he moved to fada'il al-salah. That when he spoke about now at-tahara, then come to salah. When we speak about salah, we always speak about the way you do your salah. But what is much more important is the other half of the salah. And what is the other half of the salah, jama'ah? What is it? One half of your salah is what? As-sujood, wal-ruku' and recitation. This is one half of your salah. But what is the other one? Tahara is before as-salah. But what is it? Al-khushu'. Your concentration on your salah. People, they say, I pray but I never benefit. You know why? Because you finish your salah in 5 minutes. You finish your salah in 5 minutes. By the time your mind settles, by the time your heart now starts focusing, you're done with your salah. You have to go back again to work. If you truly want to benefit from your salah, make it longer. Just make it longer. Yeah, but I don't know, I have things to do. I know, and that's why you need to make it longer, so that when you go back to doing these things, alhamdulillah, you're energized. But many of us, we only make our salah in 5 minutes, in 3 minutes, just to get over with it and move on to our lives. Even subhanAllah, when the imam recites a long surah, whether it's in dhuhr or asr, for many people this is very annoying. Why? Because people are used to قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ أَعْطَنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ. And then they stay standing silently waiting for the imam to make his ruku'. It's taking forever. When the imam, all what he did, maybe he just add one extra ayah or maybe one extra page in the salah. If the imam is reciting long rak'ah, long recitation, even in a silent salah such as dhuhr and asr, enjoy it. This is the time for you to focus and concentrate. We had when we were in Medina, as a matter of fact, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward this brother, when he used to pray, tabarakallah, he used to lead salah for us in Masjid al-Jama'ah, the Masjid of the University of Medina. He used to recite very, very, very long recitation in salat al-asr. Extremely long, subhanallah, that even people, they used to sometimes joke about it. When they hear that he's the one who's leading the salah, they will say, Salatul Qiyam, yarhamukumullah. Because literally, when you hear the iqama, if you're still in the dorm, by the time you make your wudu and put your clothes on and you walk to the masjid, it might take you about 5 more minutes maybe to get to the masjid, he is still in the first rak'ah. Still in the first rak'ah. I remember, wallahi, at some point, I was trying to measure how long he goes in the salah, mashallah, yani. In one rak'ah, I would be able to read almost, I would say, 2 rubu's. Yani basically, you talk about 4 or 5 pages sometimes. In one single rak'ah. And you recite with tartil, mashallah, nice, slowly, and so on. But this was beautiful. However, this is understood because he was leading students of knowledge, or supposedly students of knowledge in the making, yani. But if I do this here in this masjid, who's going to stay for Salat al-Asr? No one would do that. However, if you're going to be ever praying for yourself, better make it a long salah. This is when you start really benefiting from your salah. This is when you enjoy it. Because the second part of the salah is al-khushu. And that's what Imam Ibn Qudamah rahimahullah ta'ala was talking about. And the meaning, he says, حُضُورُ الْقَلْبِ is the most important aspect of salah. This is how you enjoy, how you make your salah alive. The most important aspect of it, when you bring life to your salah, is حُضُورُ الْقَلْبِ, when your heart is focusing on that salah. One time, Maymun ibn Mahran rahimahullah ta'ala, they said that he saw a man in the masjid and he was praying, and this man was scratching. Every few seconds he's scratching somewhere, his head, his hand. So he looked at him and he says, لَوْ خَشَعَ قَلْبُ خَشَعَ الْجَوَارِحُ. He said, لَوْ خَشَعَ قَلْبُ لَخَشَعَ الْجَوَارِحُ. Which means if his heart was doing khushu, was focusing in the salah and the ibadah, all his body will be following that heart in the khushu and concentration. But unfortunately, his heart was not there, therefore all his body was basically kind of itching him and scratching and all the stuff and so on. So this is something very crucial for us to understand, that when you make your salah, it's not just about doing 4 rak'ah or 3 rak'ah. Wallahi, it's not just about that. It's about what exactly you benefited from the salah. And that's why if you really feel you're not benefiting from your salah, you blame no one but yourself. Not the imam, not the recitation, not the hifd or so-and-so, no, yourself, because you're not focusing on your salah and your ibadah. Al-Imam rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned some etiquettes regarding al-Jum'ah and how to prepare for Jum'ah properly. Then he mentioned the etiquette of dhikr, al-adhkar. And alhamdulillah, now after Salat al-Isha, we're studying from Riyadh al-Salihin, the etiquette of, the dua and the adhkar as well. So we're reading that together, we're memorizing more du'as, inshallah. And I hope you guys are still memorizing these adhkar as we learn them, inshallah ta'ala, together. Al-Imam rahimahullah ta'ala, then he moved on to the second aspect of our ibadat, of the arkan, or the third rukun of arkan al-Islam, and that is al-zakah. Al-zakah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, many ayat, when he speaks about the believers, yuqimuna as-salata wa yu'tuna az-zakah, that they pray and they give zakah, pray and give zakah. It seems to us today that salah and zakah has been completely and permanently were separated from each other. Even though we're very good at making our salah on time, trying our best to make khushu' and so on, but when it comes to giving, it seems that we kind of a little bit, we're getting weaker over here. Many of us, even we focus on fasting much more than giving zakah. Although zakah was mentioned with the salah as a qareen, which means like equal or rival and equal with salah, many times in the Quran, much more than talking about fasting. But it's easier for us to do fasting than giving our money that we earned fair and square. Most of us, or some of us, would say, you know, it's easier for me to abstain from eating and drinking and get thirsty during the day for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But leaving that money and giving it away for zakah or for sadaqah, it's something that is very, very challengeable. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it always qareen as-salah, equal to the salah almost. And he mentioned about the secrets of giving that zakah. It's not about giving the money, wallahi. No, giving the zakah, it's not about giving the money. It's about you giving that money for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. It's the essence of it. Because when you give away that wealth and that money, means it's not, you're not attached to it. You're not attached to it. You're attached to the one who's given it to you. And when you, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, when you give it back, you didn't really lose much. You didn't lose anything. مَا نَقَصَ مَالُ مَنْ صَدَقَ, that no wealth is diminished by giving charity. As a matter of fact, it's increasing by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you even, it increases in your heart because you start becoming more content. Whatever left is in your hand is sufficient for you. Like in the story of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda, when the Prophet he asked for donations and for people to give money and to give their wealth. So Umar, he brought half of his wealth. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he brought everything he had. And when the Prophet ﷺ, he saw that, he saw it was too much. He said a lot, basically. He said, قَالَ مَاذَا أَبْقَيْتَ لِأَهْلِكَ, what did you leave for your family? قَالَ أَبْقَيْتُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ, I'm leaving Allah and His Messenger for them. Which means, in terms of wealth, they don't need that. Alhamdulillah, they've been covered. I leave Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger for them. Salawatullahi wa salam alayhi. So that shows you that his attachment was never to the dinar and dirham. It was never for the gold and silver. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda, has always been to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what Imam Ibn Qudama rahmatullah in this chapter was trying to emphasize, that the value of giving is not really about giving the money itself as much as purifying the heart. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about giving in the Quran, always mention the word shuh. And a shuh means stinginess, basically, and misery, misery. You're being so miserable when you give your money, just feel that part of your heart is being taken away from you. But when you don't attach yourself to this wealth, if it comes out for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will be happy. You will be happy even to find opportunities to give people for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Imam Ibn Qudama rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, even he gave specific etiquettes regarding the recipients. If you are the recipient of zakah, what should you do? How should you receive it? What should you say about upon receiving it? And if you are the one who's given it, what should be your akhlaq and your manners? Should we taunt the people with that zakah or sadaqat? Or should you just be grateful that they even accepted it from you? If you think of them as being an opportunity for you to go to Al-Jannah, that you're blessed to have someone to accept from you, you would never feel that you are at advantage over these people. Never. actually you always feel in need of people like this to give them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the etiquette of the believer. Whenever you give it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you enjoy giving this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Imam ibn Qudama rahmatullahi ta'ala alayh, then he moved on and he spoke about fasting in the month of Ramadan. And we covered that twice, as a matter of fact. One in the previous Ramadan and then afterwards while we're studying this the series, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. And then subhanAllah, amazing about the fasting. The Imam rahmatullahi ta'ala, he speaks about the essence and the secrets of fasting, that fasting is actually three levels. Number one, there is, he said, Sawm al-Umum, if you guys remember them. Sawm al-Umum. The fasting of the masses. And the meaning of the fasting of the masses means the average people, when they fast by doing what? Abstaining from food, from drink, and then from any kind of intimacy during the day. And pretty much that's what they abstain from. That's it. That's the fasting of the average people, the masses. And many, many people do that. And then he moved to the second fast. He says, Sawm al-Khusus. This is the fasting of al-Khusus, which means the fasting of the elite. This is the exclusive, private, you know, kind of fasting. It's the essence of fasting, really. And what's the meaning of this fasting of the khusus? And that is, in addition to abstaining from food and drink and intimacy, is also abstaining from committing sins and doing something haram or wrong, staying away from lying, from all these bad behaviors and characteristics. Staying away from all of this. That's the fasting of the elite. Then he moved on to Sawm Khusus Al-Khusus. Sawm Khusus Al-Khusus, that's the highest level of fasting. And what level is that, Jama'ah? He said, this is Sawm Al-Qalb an al-himam al-dani'a. The fasting of your heart, even from the least, you know, thought or idea or whims, just to commit something wrong or doing something kind of very low. So the heart is always at very high aspiration, all the time. Your heart never thinks of any obesity. Nothing crosses your heart or your mind of doing anything wrong. If you get to that level, that is the meaning of the highest level of fasting. And fasting, the physical fasting, which is the first category, is just the beginning. Abstaining from food and from drink, and so that's just the beginning of fasting. The real meaning of fasting is when you move on all the way to that level. Is that when your heart abstains completely from these evil thoughts and bad akhlaq and bad manners. Slowly and gradually, inshallah, when you get to that level, you would realize that you've been completely purified. And that helps you, inshallah, to achieve all the other things that he were talking about, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayh, regarding, you know, the akhlaq and the meaning, the essence of knowledge and the essence of giving and the essence of enjoying your salah and your ibadah. Similar to that, he mentioned also al-hajj afterwards, and we moved on from the hajj to all the other aspects of al-awrad, to help you, you know, maintain your day and your night in dhikr, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what needs to be said. He divided the day to seven specific periods, in which period this has specific, you know, format of ibadah and dhikr. And then the night has six periods as well, what to maintain in these six periods. And then who are these people who maintain these different periods during the day and during the night? He divided the time, mashallah, in an amazing way for those who would like to make a specific schedule for themselves. If you would like to follow the example and the schedule of Imam Ibn Qudama, as he was mentioned this in this book, go ahead and get back again to this particular part when he divides the time of the day and the night and how we should worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the day and during the night. Take from each, inshallah, what fits your schedule, what you can achieve and do, and start going and upgrading yourself from one level to the other until you achieve, inshallah ta'ala, the highest level of ibadah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who truly become seekers in this dunya towards the akhirah, and make us among those who seek the methodology towards the akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who always remember him abundantly during the day and during the night. Walhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Any question, Jama'ah? Tafadhal. No.
But we don't see a lot, or maybe never seen anything to talk about, you know, like how the kids they used to learn in the Medina, or the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went, for example, to the madrasa or whatever, you know, and we saw the kids, for example, memorizing Quran, and that will tie it with the Iqra, Bismi Rabbika alladhi khalaq.
No.
Reading, is it really at that time? There the book. Is
true.
It different just from a book, or different, you know, like look at the, at, you know, like the heavens and look at the earth and learn from you, look at inside yourself and learn. Different, it's not just tied to this one item.
No. Well, eventually the question is about the word Iqra. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the word Iqra, did it mean really the literal meaning of read? Or was it speaking about metaphoric expression, like saying, read the signs of the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this creation, read about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in almost every hidden secret in this world, and so forth. So it is it about really reading, yani, the actual letter? Because we know at that time the Arab didn't have books to read even to begin with. So how should we understand the word Iqra? Well, we understand that from the reaction of the Prophet ﷺ first and foremost. Because when Jibreel came to him and he says, read, what was the answer of the Prophet ﷺ? قَالْ مَا أَنَا بِقَارِ, I don't know how to read. So the first thing we know about the word Iqra, it means I don't know how to read, that he was denying the immediate meaning of the word, which is the actual reading and writing. But then Jibreel, he would squeeze him and would let him go and says, read in the name of your Lord. So I don't know how to read. So the Prophet was denying that he is able of reading because he was illiterate, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Is it like what I will read or I don't know how to read?
Both. It means, which means, was he questioning or was he wondering about what exactly do you want me to read? Or was he saying, I don't even know how to read? So eventually, the Prophet was denying the fact that he was able to read, salawatullahi wa sallam alayhi. However, I don't deny, there is no doubt that that when it comes to the tafsir al-Qur'an, and our mashayikh, Shaykh al-Shanqita, habidahullah ta'ala, one time we asked him about a specific meaning for an ayah. He said, al-Qur'an hammal awjuh, which means the Qur'an sometimes, you know, have different shades in terms of the meanings. And subhanAllah, why do we need all these tafsir that we have today? Every single generation produced more tafsirs. Although we have Al-Qurtubi and Al-Tabari and Ibn Kathir and so on, why do we even need more tafsirs today? Because subhanAllah, just like I said, if knowledge develops and also doubles every 900 days, can you imagine how much we can really understand from the Qur'an, profoundly from the Qur'an, if we really have, alhamdulillah, new insight and new access to more knowledge about the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So yeah, definitely, when it comes to reading right now, reading is just the beginning. But it's not just about reading the letter, it's reading what is behind the letter that was sent to us. Wallahu ta'ala alam. So yeah, maybe the science can get in there, inshallah ta'ala. Any questions? Sisters? Okay, so with this, inshallah ta'ala, we conclude our sessions from Mukhtasar Minhaj al-Qasidin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward Imam ibn Qudam wa rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi and all the ulama who wrote this book and summarized this book and had the original book, Imam al-Ghazali rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. May Allah reward you all for participating in this, and I hope that you guys can go back again, inshallah ta'ala, and read for yourself and summarize this and learn and practice. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all again. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
الذي جعل لكم الأرض فراشا والسماء بناء وأنزل من السماء ماء فأخرج به من الثمرات رزقا لكم فلا تجعلوا لله أندادا وأنتم تعلمون وإن كنتم في ريب